Stay tuned for the latest message excerpt from Impact Church.
It's the story of the gospel, and it's the story of what Jesus is doing in the lives of people all around us. And I just wanted him to share that because you never know if you're that person that God will speak to and say, why don't you talk to somebody? It could be a Tim Hortons, and I love that story because it doesn't have to be in a church service. It doesn't have to be, you know, right after worship and right after the word and during an altar call when the atmosphere is right in the church, if you will. It can be anywhere, anytime when the Holy Spirit speaks and we obey. God is able to transform lives. Amen. A couple of quick things I want to mention. We've got some resources at the back. A couple of years ago, we talking to churches, speaking all over the province and even in the nations, one of the things we realized was a lot of people felt ill-equipped to be able to share the gospel with people that believed differently from them, different backgrounds, different religious backgrounds, different cultural backgrounds. And so we started something called the Go Conference. It was an opportunity to bring in people that had come to faith in Christ from a specific background. And it could be an addiction. It could be, like I said, a religious background. It could be an ethnic background, something that's different. You're like, I don't know how to talk to that person. I just don't understand how they think so I can relate to them. And so we've had the conference now 3 years. We started with 200. Last year, we had 2,000. And God's been really increasing it. And we've been seeing a lot of people being equipped. So out in the lobby today, we've got DVDs from the last few years of the conference, in the last 3 years of the conference. And so I want you to check it out. This is the 2017 DVD, and one of the speakers on here, his name is Mark Clark. Mark grew up in Ajax, Ontario, grew up in a home that was a Christian home. He shares this joke. He says, his dad named his older brother Matthew, and someone told him after the fact that Matthew was in the Bible. He says, my dad was so mad, he named his second son Mark. Because he just had no clue. I mean, and that's his joke. He has to say that, you know, they were just not a Bible-believing family, you know. And Mark has a story of just being in drugs and different things, and yet God saved him through the testimony of a high school friend. And he moved to Vancouver a few years ago, and he pastors the Village Church, one of the fastest-growing churches, largest churches in Canada. In 7 years, they've seen over 1,200 people baptized. They have about 5,000 people attend their church. And we brought him in because a lot of people say, you know, Pastor Fanu, you can do this in Africa. The thousands will come. You can do this in South America. But, you know, Canada is different. People don't want Jesus here. It doesn't work in Canada. And I said, you know what? That's not true. Then, you know, they say, oh, you know, the millennials don't want Jesus. And I'm like, you know, Mark's 36 years old. And he is a leading voice in our nation. And so just an incredible story. So if you get the DVD, you can hear his session. And also, he wrote a book, and we have a few copies left from the conference. It's called The Problem of God, Answering a Skeptic's Challenge to Christianity. And I'll tell you, it's probably one of the best apologetic books I've read in a long time. And he discusses what people say is the reason, the problem with God. You know, I don't believe in the Bible. How do you know it's true? You mean science hasn't already proven factually that the gospel isn't real, that the Bible isn't true? And he talks about those issues that our culture a lot of times will say, this is why I don't come to church. He talks about the problem of sex. He talks about the problem of Jesus and if Jesus was a historical person. So if you have somebody that asks a lot of these questions, this is a great resource to give to them and pray that the Spirit of God will work in their hearts. Amen. Let's turn in our Bibles this morning, please, to Matthew chapter 27. Matthew 27, and we're going to read from verse 15 to 23, and then we're going to go to the Gospel of Mark in chapter 1. First, Matthew 27. We're continuing the series that we're in as a church on, it's called Welcome Home. And I want to talk to you this morning of what God's home should look like. I've titled the message, The Jesus Franchise. The Jesus Franchise. And I'll explain in a moment here. But let's read Matthew 27:15. I'm reading from the New Revised Standard Version here. It says, "Now, at the festival, the governor was accustomed to release a prisoner for the crowd, anyone whom they wanted. At that time, they had a notorious prisoner called Jesus Barabbas. So after they had gathered, Pilate said to them, 'Whom do you want me to release for you, Jesus Barabbas or Jesus who was called the Messiah?' For he realized that it was out of jealousy that they had handed him over. While he was sitting on the judgment seat, his wife sent word to him, 'Have nothing to do with that innocent man, for today I have suffered a great deal because of a dream about him.' Now the chief priests and the elders persuaded the crowds to ask for Barabbas and to have Jesus killed. The governor again said to them, 'Which of the two do you want me to release for you?' And they said, 'Barabbas.' Pilate said to them, 'Then what should I do with Jesus who is called the Messiah?' All of them said, 'Let him be crucified.'" Now, Mark chapter 1 and verse 16 says this. The Gospel of Mark chapter 1 and verse 16 says, "One day, as Jesus was walking along the shore of the Sea of Galilee, he saw Simon and his brother Andrew throwing a net into the water, for they fished for a living. Jesus called out to them, 'Come, follow me, and I will show you how to fish for people.' And they left their nets at once and followed him. A little farther up the shore, Jesus saw Zebedee's sons, James and John, in a boat repairing their nets. He called them at once, and they also followed him, leaving their father Zebedee in the boat with the hired men." Eyes closed, let's pray this morning. Father, we thank you for your word in this house. We thank you that the flower fades and the grass withers, but your word is forever the same. I thank you that your word will not return void, but it will accomplish the purposes for which it is being sent forth today. In the name of Jesus, we come against every spirit of unbelief and doubt, every spirit of confusion and distraction. Lord, I pray, Spirit of God, that you would minister to the hearts of your people today. Have your way in this place, we pray, in Jesus' name. And God's people said, you know, very interesting. I just want to preface what I'm going to share with you this morning with Matthew 27 and what happens there. And the New Revised, highlights this aspect of the scripture that Barabbas, we know Barabbas, obviously, was one of the prisoners that was released. There was an option between Jesus and Barabbas. And what I found interesting, and I looked at some of the writings and the commentaries related to this, and one of the things that comes up is that Barabbas most likely had the first name Jesus as well. You remember now, the name Jesus comes from, Joshua in the Old Testament, this idea of God is my salvation. It was a common name. Jesus' name was a common name at the time. And so I started thinking about it. I said, wow, interesting how they basically had two options. And Barabbas actually means the son of a father. Bar is son of, Abba, father, master, son of a father. So you've got two sons of two fathers as the option for the people to choose. Two Jesuses, if you will, for them to choose. And I want to share that, not because that's my message this morning, but you know, often we have to choose which Jesus do we say we follow. Is it the Jesus of the Bible? Is it the Son of God? Is it the Messiah? Or is it a Jesus that we have fabricated for ourselves because this is convenient for them? Barabbas. Jesus Barabbas was more convenient. That's who they chose as opposed to Jesus the Messiah, because what? His sayings were too hard for them. What he talked about, what he preached about, how he called them to repentance was not comfortable. So they would rather have the other Jesus than the one who spoke from the Father, the one who did what he saw the Father do. You know, we live in a world today where there's a lot of people that will call on the name of Jesus, but the question is, which Jesus do we believe in? Have we made up a Jesus for ourselves, or do we follow, do we read the word and say, hey God, here's what your word says about your son, here's how your word asks me to live my life, here's how your word asks me to order my home.
so I can welcome people not to my home, but to God's home.